introduce Mirko Zardini. As usual, there were about three pages of notes and achievements, and I was going to tell you a few things about this, and then Mr. Zardini decided that it's a five-line introduction. An architect, he's worked in Casabella and Domus, he's worked at the Venice Biennale, he's curated, and he's now director of the CCA. You all know the CCA, but I just wanted to introduce Mirko in a different way, because this morning I Googled and then found the Canadian Centre for Architecture. That's a question I'm going to ask him later, why it isn't the Centre for Canadian Architecture, because that's an interesting question, CCA. But when you download the information from the website, you get an incredible newsletter. You just realize what Mirko has done over the 5 years. There's the Mellon Lecture Series. There's an incredible list of different types of lectures. There's a family program. There's exhibitions on view. There's the Friends of the CCA. There's the collection. There's the online. It's probably one of the most vibrant centers for architecture, certainly in this part of the world, but I would compare it with somewhere like Vienna and the Architecture Centrum in Vienna, or the Museum of Finnish Architecture, which doesn't have this range at all. And it really is thanks to Mirko Zardini that he's taken it this way. So tonight he's going to talk about critical space. And then I asked him what the subtext was to critical space, and he said he wrote about 10 of them. But basically, all of them actually raise a question. Critical space, does it matter? Thank you, Mirko Zardini.
So thank you very much. I think it is, for me, it's really an honor, also especially a pleasure to be here tonight. And again, in this forum lecture series, I really would like to thank Marco Frascari, Cheryl Boyle, and for inviting me, Roger, Conan, and Federica Goffi for having helped to shape this intervention, for the nice word, and the architect Lalande and Doyle, because I think it's very important that this kind of joint venture in between the architecture scene in Ottawa and the School of Architecture. So what I'm going to do tonight, well, I'll try to touch some topics which I think are very interesting for us. And when I say us, I intend us as architects, urban planner, urban designer, landscape architects, but also as curators, as institutions related to this issue. An institution means both a center like CCA, but also a university, a school of architecture and university. How can I say? Generally, we always tend to say that the conditions are different. And this is a kind of standard sentence that I hear all the time since I was a student at school. Somebody was coming to me and say, well, but you know, the conditions are different and we have to do something different. And in a certain way, it's always true. The conditions are always different. They are different in a different way. And nevertheless, I would like to say that today we are really venturing in a kind of uncharted territory, more than 10, 20 years ago. The objective that I have in this time that I'm going to spend with you is really to try to go through some of the problems, some of the issues that are part of the activity of CCA, Canadian Center for Architecture, of university, of an architect in the profession. Which are the problems that we are facing? Which are the issues that we are facing today? Let's start from a general expectation that you could have, and everybody has, when you arrive or you look at an institution like the CCA. This is an image by purpose, an image not symmetric, not showing the 1980s facade built by Peter Rose in 20 years ago, but trying to show you something happening outside, a banner, a door where you enter. What is happening when you go through the door? But especially, which kind of idea of architecture you would expect presented when you visit a place like CCA? Let's start from the vaults, from the collection. You imagine that in that place you have a certain kind of material there. It's true. In these kind of spaces, in the vaults, you have hundreds of thousands of drawings, photographs, models, postcards, documents, letters, brochure, technical brochure, airplane tickets, program brief coming from the city, from the client, everything collected in this general idea of an archive. Because CCA is really based on this idea of the archive. And I would like to spend a few words about that, because it's telling you something which is also very important about the idea of architecture, or a certain idea of architecture. There are, I start from the end, there are institutions which are collecting a nice drawing and a final model that perhaps you have done for the presentation of one of your projects. It's fine. We at CCA, we collect, if I come to your office and I would like to have something from you, I'll ask you to have a project, at least. And perhaps I don't ask you to give me, as a donation, the final model, but perhaps a working model. And perhaps I ask you not to give me perhaps the best drawing that you did, but perhaps I'm more interested in all the sketches on the preparatory work that you did. And perhaps I'm interested to have the letters or the emails that you exchange with somebody. And if you have on your table the brochure of a or on the downloaded from the web some technical elements related to the project or to some technical components, I ask to have also those. What does it mean? That we are interested not in a nice drawing, but in the thinking about architecture and in all the things that they could relate architecture to a larger field than architecture itself, which means the society, the culture to which we belong. So what we really value a lot is architecture as part of a more a larger cultural, social, political environment, which we are able to represent, to interpret through the work that each of us is doing. Now, is this the only thing? No. Let's go some floors, two floors up, and to go really to the exhibition space, which is generally the space that you see when you come at CCA. And you will see that is an exhibition that we did, which is very archival in its intention. It was the presentation of four important archives which arrived at CCA, was called Out of the Box, and we presented the archive work, the material arrived from the archive of Aldo Rossi, from the archive of Jim Sterling. These are the sketches for the Stuttgart Museum. And the material coming from the archive of Sari Price. These are the newspapers articles on the famous unbuilt project of Sari Price, the Fun Palace. Mainly very negative article. But why this material is at CCA? Why is so important for us to have this material? We can say that is important because two of these people, they got the Pritzker Prize in architecture, which means Rossi and Sterling, but it's not the real point. The material is there because these architects, they produce a very relevant reflection and discussion on architecture in a period of going from the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, which was addressing the crisis of modernism after the Second World War. And they addressed that in a very different way. Rossi, for example, going back to an idea of the shape of the city, the form of the city. Sterling, this is the project, of course, the Stuttgart Museum, with the process of this assemblage of the typological machine that he had built at the beginning of his career, and a reassemblage in a kind of urban context, and Price developing presenting a very open-end, flexible building, which was created. The project was done in total connection with the project of a theater, which was not anymore a theater, but was a performance space conceived together with the famous client, John Littlewood. She was the director of this company. And it was a representation of how architecture contributed to the rethinking of institution, activities, culture in a period like the 60s and the 70s. And you have also, in that, there was in that exhibition, the work of Mata Clark. You know that Mata Clark was a student of architecture at Cornell. He also was the son of the painter Mata. And what is interesting in his work, more than the cuts, is a kind of anthropological thinking of the space of architecture. So all this kind of material, this kind of projects are there because we think that it is very important to have this material. They represent a very strong, interesting idea of architecture in a specific period, which was very relevant, which is very critical, which contributed to a kind of discussion in a period marked by a kind of anxiety about the modern idea of architecture. So for us, it's important to have these kind of things. It's very, very important. They are crucial for a discussion which happened in the past and most probably for a discussion that could happen today. In fact, these archives, especially Sari Price and Mata Clark, are today incredibly used because a lot of students, architect scholars, they find in this material, in this thinking, something which they think it is useful to elaborate a discourse also today. But again, that is necessary, but I don't think that it is sufficient for us. What is relevant for architecture today? First of all, what does it mean today? You know, again, there are always a different interpretation of the today, especially when the today started. It's never the present, the today. Is something which started a little bit before and will end a little bit later, and you are there for a certain period of time. And it's very important how we describe for each of us what is today, because it's telling us which are our reference point, which is our interpretation of the reality in which we live. So I'm going to tell you what is my interpretation of today. And my interpretation of today is of a period of time which started years ago, in 1973. Because in 1973, in the October, you see this page of the New York Times. You see the title on the right, Soviets Seek Cairo Peace Move, and Arabs cut export 5% a month. Why is that important that day? You know, it was the beginning of another war among Arabs countries and Israel, and the reaction of the Arab countries to the direct and indirect support of the Dutch and the Americans to the Israel army was to establish an embargo on the oil export, 5% per month, cut down, increasingly reduced every month. And it was a pure political decision. There was no real shortage of oil, but the effect of that decision was very important because it produced a situation that today we face more and more, the idea of a real shortage of energy. Now, this is a very interesting point because it's marking the end, this kind of moment, of an idea of progress and modernity as something which was continuously based on the idea of an infinite growth. In a certain way, was the collapse of an idea of modernity as a constant progress based on infinite resources, and based also on another point, which Truman, President Truman, made very clear in his speech in January 1949, when he stated that greater production is the key to prosperity and peace, and the key to greater production is a wider and more vigorous application of modern scientific and technical knowledge. So I think that everything, this kind of idea, ended in that moment. But nevertheless, I think that this change that started in that moment is not only related to content and strategy, the content specific of the project. What we are facing today in this condition in which we are is also a deep change in the real process of production, of discussion, and communication of architecture too. So what is interesting for us, considering that we are, and perhaps we could, you could question that and we can have a discussion about that, considering that we live in this period, what is interesting for us, or for me, is to explore which is today, how can I say, the hidden undeclared agenda which is behind most of the projects that we do. I am very interested to explore the dark side, or better, the gray zone, and try to make this hidden agenda visible. I'm interested to explore, how can I say, the prejudgment that are the base of our daily operation, and to see if they are reasonable, where do they bring us in our daily actions. I'm not going it's not the kind of manifesto that I'm going to present to you, it's not even a retroactive manifesto. Is a kind of a reflection that we can do at CCA now after 5 years of activities, trying to also for us to understand better how we develop this kind of a critical discourse. How did they try to investigate these issues? In which way, and if we have been successful or not? Our intention is mainly to raise some questions. We were not able to get answer yet. We never pretend to have a proper answer to everything. But at least you know that a good question sometimes is very useful to produce very interesting thinking. So let's start from what is, I just started now, to continue with this theme of the energy crisis, 1973. We did an exhibition about that, Sorry Out of Gas. And why we did that? Because in a certain way, we are very irritated with this kind of buzzword, which is called sustainability. Because we think that this idea of sustainability, as is developed today, both at the political, in the political discourse, in the cultural discourse, and in the architectural discourse, is mainly a kind of a greenwashing of contemporary architecture. Because we think that it's not very different from a branding strategy, the famous branding strategy of BP, Beyond Petroleum, which launched this incredible campaign. And despite which we discovered the hard way that the most basic security measures have never been really put in place by BP in their factories, in their plants, and in the extraction sites. So what is the problem that we have? This is an image of a highway in Germany in the fall of 1973. What is the real problem about sustainability and architecture? That today, this issue is really linked very often to some statistic metrics, to a kind of idea to deploy a higher performance technology. And this is a kind of solution that we are looking at. LEED system is an example of that. Well, I don't think that we can reduce architecture to functional requirements in this sense. I don't think that this kind of green functionalism is the real answer to the problems that we have. And the reason that we went to 1973 is for two reasons. On one side, this is an image of course, in New York State, after the American government started to think, even in the United States, to a rationing system for the gasoline. And we went on eBay and we were able to get for our collection one of these coupons, which were produced by US government and never put in place, distributed. But anyway, it was the end of this drive-in society based on the automobile and the suburban development. There is a famous book by Daniel Yergin speaking of the age of hydrocarbon man as the ending in that year. But also, it was very, very important that situation because, and here you see on this screen some of the board games that in that period were produced, describing the different situation, the idea of the energy crisis, the exploration of the North Sea, a possible war US-Iraq, which by the way happened some years later. And at the very end there, you also see a small panel there, which was the panel that Jimmy Carter put on the roof of the White House, and it was the same panel that Ronald Reagan took off the first days that he was as the new president at the White House. So it was a very interesting period. What did the architects in that period? They were looking at alternative energy issues, a lot of technological research. These things were already there. the energy problem just in that area, in that period, made these things accelerate, become this research to accelerate, to become more relevant and more present. They have been, MIT had already produced solar houses starting in the 30s. In 19th century, already you had the problem of heating the water with the sun. You had this project by the Moore Tromb, the Tromb Wall, there on the you see the representation there, which was of the 60s by this French engineer, passive energy control. And you have research on the ground, the wind, insulation. So it was an incredible moment of research in the field of architecture. But what was very interesting in that period is that solar architecture, if you want to call it like that, which corresponds to the moment in which the sun became a source not anymore of light but also of heat and energy, solar architecture was already there, more than a technical solution. If you look at the work of that period, of some groups, you see that I can Farallones, CAT, ILS Lab, New Alchemist, Uroboros. What they did, the most interesting thing that they did was not to redefine a new idea of a perfectly autonomous house in the desert or in the suburbs. What was the real achievement that they have been able to arrive at? Was to outline alternative social models, different lifestyles, to develop a proposal for buildings and communities in urban environments, to introduce these energy issues in a cycle which was not the architecture, the production, the building cycle only, but was going from food production to waste recycling. So they were able to look at the sustainability, whatever you want to call, problem in a more, in a larger way, larger than the one that ourselves do today with this kind of a LEED certification system. In reality, one of the problems that we see in the contemporary culture, and is sustainability could be treated in the same way, is a kind of wish that we have to, how can I say, to maintain all the positive aspects of our lifestyle, not to give up to anything, but just to purge a little bit that things of something that could be inappropriate or offensive, even if it is very essential of the things. And there is a very nice description of Zizek. He's speaking, he's very, how can I say, perhaps too fashionable today to quote him, but nevertheless, he is at a certain point speaking of our lifestyle, and he's speaking of our Western society, and speaking of a society in which we have now coffee without caffeine, cream without fat, beer without alcohol, virtual sex as sex without sex, Colin Powell doctrine of warfare with no casualties on our side, as a warfare without warfare, politics as the art of expert administration, it means politics without politics. So in certain way, the critique of trying to enjoy all the advantages without facing the inevitable negative consequences. And when I look at how architects are describing the sustainable process, I look at that. I don't think that to reduce that to a zero emission, zero energy building is very different than to have a coffee without caffeine. If you look at the problem from the perspective, for example, of an ecologist, they will question I imagine Suzuki, but also an architect or a critique like Buchanan, they will question the fact that, for example, we never consider embedded energy in what we do. We never consider waste and recycling, not enough. Some of us, they say, of course, we recycle so much and so much, but how important is for us the lasting of the building, the possibility of future use? How much do you enlarge the sustainable approach from the specificity of the building to the urban environment? You know, if I enlarge the sustainable analysis from the building to the an urban environment, I have to introduce the problem of traffic, I have to introduce the problem of the community, I have to introduce the problem, an incredible set of problems which are much larger than architecture. So I have nothing against a sustainable building as we generally consider that. I think it's absolutely necessary. I'm only thinking that it is not enough. Let's continue with this conversation, otherwise it's becoming a little bit too much of these, and I promise that I'll go a little bit faster. Let's introduce the idea of the environment. What does it mean, environment, for us as architects? I have the suspect that, how can I say, for us is mainly to create a nice, visual, compelling landscape. Now, I think it is nice, it's interesting to have things like that. I'm a little bit worried if for us environment is to have a lot of green roof only. Or nice gardens or parks. I think that really the problem of the environment is much, much deeper than that. And we have to understand this issue in a different way. First of all, clearly we have to shift from an anthropocentrical perspective of the environment to a much larger one in which you consider the environment in respect to the future generation, for example. But let's look at the work of some people that we invited to work with us on this kind of issues. This is the work of a landscape architect, perhaps you know him, is Gilles Clément. He wrote a very nice book on the third landscape. And what is Gilles Clément is telling us is that in reality, we have to look at the problem of the environment in terms of biodiversity. These are photos of a lawn that he bought, and then every summer he went there to analyze how the lawn was evolving, which plants were arriving, which insects. And it was a long study that he did, trying to understand this idea of the relationship of what we do with the idea of a kind of biodiversity, which more and more put at risk from the extreme rationalization of the environment in which we live, produced by our actions. For example, the idea of the rationality of agriculture, rationality of the urban infrastructure, and so on, they are taking over more and more larger and larger surfaces. And what is very worrying for him is this kind of inevitably reduction of the space for a freedom, a kind of a biodiversity freedom, which will be allowed where? In his opinion, is allowed only today in the leftover spaces of this kind of huge rational approach to the environment that is at the base of our actions. And what you see there, here, is a kind of, how can I say, a collection of material that he found in a small space in Montreal between a highway and railways. He went there and he collected what was there. So you see the waste of our life, but also you see that this leftover space is a kind of place for reproduction of a natural biodiversity, plants, unexpected plants growing up there, and these kind of things. So it's a little bit scary, this message, but very interesting. And another message coming to that, questioning this idea of environment as a pure visual landscape, is coming from the work of Philip Ram. Philip Ram is a Swiss architect. He worked on the idea of the climate. He's trying to build a new reflection for architecture, starting from a claim for a stronger attention on our side on climatic condition. When he speaks of climate, he speaks of microclimate, of course. This is a kind of abstract representation of interior space. The lighting that you see there, they are moving, creating a different change in temperature. What the other things that you see there are the sensors. And what he did was to monitor that, of course, increasing the scale of the change in order to make this visible, making a program which was making visible how the different condition, climatic condition created by the change of temperature or humidity, they could become the base of a different thinking of the interior space on the project of the architects. And what you see on the table are also the projects that he did, which perhaps more interesting to look at the concept that he presented. Let's go back to this issue of the visual. Is it true that architecture is a visual art? Yes, for sure. Perhaps it's not only that. When we did this work on the sense of the city, the main reason to do that was really to challenge the prevalence of the visual in our perception of the environment, the urban environment in that case, in which we live. This prevalence is coming, how can I say, at the expense of other sensorial experiences that we have. But also is an experience, this one of the sensorial, that is deeply based not only on physiological differences that more or less each of us is ready to acknowledge, especially in respect to the animals, but also on cultural differences. You know that in the scale of values, the visual is very strong for us, but perhaps in Africa, the smell is much more important than the visual in some cultures. So why we were interested in these kind of issues, first of all, because we think that in speaking of the quality of the environment, very often today, we have an approach which is purely quantitative. We are interested to have a clean air, not to have a smog. We have some standards to clean the air. We know when it's polluted or not. Is it important? For sure. Is it enough? Well, I think that could be nice also if we start to think of the quality of the experience of the air. Perhaps we can think of the smell sometimes. Is it important to deal with new technologies in order to improve the environment? For sure. Has always been done. Think of the asphalt. This is a piece of natural asphalt. This is a piece of a special asphalt, the one that is used in the highway, how do you call, I'm sorry for the English word, to absorb the water, not to create the problem of the water covered with the surface. Anyway, asphalt was a technical invention, very important. Was created for pedestrian, not for the cars, 1830s. Then architects and municipality engineers, they were totally fascinated with that. And they started to use, to propose asphalt for everything, for the roof, for the walls, for the surface of the street. There are some brochures in which you can see a kind of completely black world covered completely by asphalt. Was covered, this idea of these new technologies, new material was, how can I say, associated with symbolic values of democracy, because asphalt became a kind of democratization of the public space, suddenly became associated with cars, and that is the end of the asphalt, because then it became bad before it was good. And that is a history of how technology is used by us to improve the environment, to reach certain objectives, and then perhaps during the time is changing the role and the objectives of this technology. And why is that is important, the asphalt? Because the asphalt is a kind of a symbol of something which is very present in our mentality, a kind of idea of hygienization or sanitization of the environment that is very, very strong in together with this idea of the visual control and rigor that we have. And it's something that is a kind of behind most of the action and the projects that we do. So why we did this exhibition, why we addressed that? Because we wanted to raise these issues about that, about technology, about the environment, the objective that we have when we address the environment in a certain way. If we can improve an idea of the environment, an experience of the environment, which is more than the visual one. But we had another task in doing that. It's true that it is much better to have a nice sensorial experience when you are in an urban space than to have a terrible one, clearly. The point is that we wanted to criticize the kind of the prevalence of the visual that in the last 20 years has marked most of the architectural production. And we wanted to say that perhaps shifting the attention from the visual to the idea of experience, we were able to escape for a while this idea of marketing trap in which architecture has confined itself in the production starting from the 80s, 90s till 2000, till our days. Is it, I have another question for you, not a lot, but some of them. One is about the idea of living. Now, if you read the newspapers, you always, every page you encounter, both if you read on the screen or on paper, you encounter on every screen or in every page, you encounter this word global. And there is also the assumption in most of us and some architects and books that you are living in a global condition, and the condition of living will be more and more similar, so that it will not make a big difference to live in London or Tokyo, because in reality, or in New York and Berlin, because in reality the conditions are very similar, and this and that. So we wanted to understand if that is really true. And we took two architects. One is Stephen Taylor from London, and one is Nishizawa, Sana, Ryu Nishizawa from Tokyo. And we took the two of them because some of their projects, they could be found together in a book on minimalism in architecture. You know, you could find a nice building by or a project by Taylor, and another, after a few pages, a project by Nishizawa or by Sana, and you can find them under the same, how can I say, category, minimalism. But and we are used to that. We are used to this formal understanding of the issues. But if you want to go a little bit further and to understand how are these houses
you will discover that the idea of living behind the house of Steven Taylor is totally different than the idea of living behind the house of Nishizawa. And it is totally different because the idea of privacy, public, semi-public, is totally different in the English culture and in the Japanese culture. We are used today, perhaps we are seeing a rediscovery of the role of planning. Is a kind of inevitable choice, considering that, for example, sustainable issues can be addressed only at a larger scale in a proper way, is a continuation of what I said to you before. But is it true that we architects are, or planners, or urban designers, have the right to take, and are we sure we are going to take the right decision? I'm not speaking of participation. I'm speaking of an incredible energy which is now coming out from a lot of actions that are taking places in the urban environment. And these are out, some of them are produced by architects, but most of them are produced by individuals, groups, associations, which are taking over the urban space in a different way. We collected 99 of that at CCA, and then we put those on the web because we wanted to create a critical mass of these small mini actions to understand how much, if you put all of them together, you can produce a real transformation of an urban environment. And we put that on the web because we hoped that other people, they could take advantage of that. And in a certain way, this is the collection that we created, which we are more proud of, because as a kind of immediate possibility to become a real tool of transformation in the reality of the urban context today, in the urban environment. Well, what you see here is perhaps the Hague Line in New York in the photo on the hand. The Hague Line was created by a small group of people who started to make photocopies to protect that kind of infrastructure in the city, pushing for the transformation in the public space. You see these lamps there? They are used by a group of architects in Spain to go around to light spaces in the city which are under threat of unwelcome development projects. And they go around, they light that during the night, and during the day they go around to ask the different families to donate some electricity to recharge these. What you see there is a website related to the security control in the city. They are telling you the pattern to avoid the cameras. This one is about the idea of sharing, recycling objects instead of putting them in the dumping, and go on. This one, of course, is in the Toronto, the kind of secret squad which during the night is going around to paint illegal bicycle lines in Toronto, because if you go through the bureaucracy, you are sure you will never get anything, at least for 5 years. So what does it mean? And what you see here is the kind of provocative project of an artist which developed this kind of special clause, showing how, if we go through the municipality offices and the public offices, how most of their intention is to make unusable the public space today. So Clearly, we are facing a kind of deterioration today of a contemporary society, at least in the public space. We are facing also a problem of a decline of the individual personal ability to do or to make something. So I think it was very refreshing and very important to be able to find these kind of actions, like something like a microbe-like practice that could produce some transformation. Now, in the last 20 years, at least in Europe, architects and planners, they spent most of their time to describe the transformation of the urban environment. You have plenty of atlas of the transformation of the Dutch cities and Italian cities. You have plenty of photography and photography commission for the French cities and everywhere. Well, while we were so busy in describing this, we have seen emerging in a total unexpected way a lot of action coming from a total different side, dealing with the idea of walking, dealing with the idea of gardening, recycling, and playing in the city, which perhaps we can look at now to see what we can learn from that and how can we use that, or how can we participate to that? A few small questions for you. Are we able to recognize that behind most of our actions, what we do every day, our daily life, there is a kind of undeclared fascination with speed, which is coming from the modern time, clearly, from the Futurist manifesto one century ago. Are we still in that kind of situation? Do we accept that? Speed has become something very important in the construction, in the urban, in terms of development, but it's something much, much more. Is a fascination, is our culture is totally embedded with this idea of speed, the role of the car, the fascination of the speed in the urban environment, and the fascination with the speed and efficiency in the work, but also in the activity inside the house, in our daily life, in the kitchen, in the work. This fascination with the speed is so strong that, of course, the photo that you see there is one of the fastest speaking person in the world who was then a testimonial for a FedEx famous ad of some years ago. And you have drugs here, clearly, trying to enhance our potential and these kind of things. How do you want Do you want to recognize that? Do you want to see that as a problem? Can we say that we can speak of speed today because perhaps the era of this modern idea of speed could be considered finished, and we can think not of one speed, but a different level of speeds? How important could be that when we do a project? And how important is technology for us? We took, and how do we look at that? We took this kind of work, this super studio work, which they produced for the, when we had the landing on the moon. And there is today clearly a new discovery of new fascination with technology. A fascination with technology, again, considering technology in a very naive way, only the, how can I say, the nice side of technology, never looking at the dark side of technology, I'll say the gray side of technology. And it is very interesting because, you know, in the 70s, Super Studio developed this kind of celebration of the technological conquest of the space. But when they, this is the famous highway that they draw in between the Earth and the Moon, but they were looking at the Moon, if you look at their sketches, more as a mirror of the Earth. How do we look at technology today as architects? Creating mainly scenarios for science fiction films for Hollywood is part of this creation of, again, of an imagery, a vision inside which we are going to be part, as we are part of the myth of the speed, we are going to be again part of the myth of a space exploration. And what is doing, for example, Michael Moltzen? Keep in mind that both Michael Moltzen and Greg Lynn, they work in California, which is very interesting, because California is the place where you have this kind of high, sophisticated technological development today. And Michael Moltzen is doing a project for a building for the research laboratory on the Earth, and he has the problem to conceive a space for the techno-bureaucracy which will be hosted in that building. And this is what you see, what this techno-bureaucracy will do, will spend, send a machine in the space, and for 10 years people will sit in front of a screen looking at this kind of data coming from the computer, coming from the machine in the space. But it's an incredible point, because it's a kind of representation of the elite, a kind of a major element of a dynamic transformation of our society, this techno-bureaucracy. So what is interesting to see is that you have the possibility to explore very, very different ideas of technology. Look also at Super Studio, what they did a few years after the Moon Highway. They started to look at a peasant, a farmer, living nearby Florence, and to make a survey of, and of course, this is a drawing that they did just now to compare the two, or to unify the two figures of Aldrin and this farmer, looking at how he was reusing the objects. How was the life on the Earth? Which was the relationship with the tools? Can we still speak of tools today? Or better, us to speak of system? Well, honestly, we don't know. But I don't discover many of these questions when I look at some architectural project. And last, Canada is a very, apparently, is declared as an open society. We have a lot of migration in Canada. Most regions are based, developing on the base of an incredible amount of immigrants. We have all over the world problems related to conflicts, to walls, to borders, to clash of different cultures. What does it happen? First of all, which is our general attitude of our culture about that? We started with two metaphors. This one is the cucumber, and these that you see on the table are the rules of the European community. You can be considered a cucumber only if you are not too curve. And if not, you are not allowed to enter the category of cucumber and be sold in Europe. And we compare that with the coconut, of course, which is a typical fruit. A lot of environmentalists are referring to that as something that can move freely through the borders and the spaces following the stream of the ocean. So we wanted to look at not the conflicts, but what is happening when you have some ideas, some objects, some people moving from one place to another one. What is the effect on the environment? The result, which is the transformation, the improvements. We analyze in this room, for example, how the word, the concept of bungalows has changed in time and in space, producing totally different ideas. Or in this room, we analyzed how the African population, the slaves that from United States went back to Liberia, what they did when they arrived there. Because when they came back to Liberia, to their original place, they built buildings which had a strong resemblance, not with the traditional architecture of the place, but with the South American mansion building. South of the United States, the New Orleans. And what is happening in Canada, when some local population have been asked by government to move and to relocate, what they did, they move their houses with them, too expensive to build a new house. And these houses, which originally they were on the, perhaps on the lake, on the river, they ended up on the small hill. What is happening when Japanese, they move to Bolivia, and they change the agricultural system? Or when immigrants from Indonesia, they come back and they take in the Netherlands and they take over this Bijlmer, this wonderful modern dream, a kind of symbol of modern housing architecture. And what is happening when in the 19th century, 20th century, the Italians from Carrara, they moved to Vermont to work in the cave of stones, bring with them their idea of working the stone in a certain way and building certain buildings in a certain way. And what is happening today when you have Chinese people working in Africa? Programs, outcome that you expect from an institution. But what is happening is also putting us in a critical situation. First of all, I hope you understood from the short excursus that we don't want to do exhibition of architecture, but we decided to do exhibition about architecture, which is a very different thing. We wanted, considering the situation, we have been not wanted, we have been forced to think in this moment, to do exhibition in a different way, trying to address issues and to address problems which are of interest for most of the people in our society. That is the first thing. The second thing is that, of course, we always produce books, we like books, we think they are very important. But also the technology is putting all the institutions, museum in particular, in a very difficult situation. You have to be able to recognize that there is another world outside, that is not anymore possible to rely on the community that physically access your building, that you have to think of somebody out of that, which will, who will connect to you only through the web. And we did a lot of things for that. We try to rethink the institution in respect to that. And we think that there is a potential there. You can do things that you can do. We can do a website in which we put all the actions, and a lot of people, they put other actions, and we hope that somebody, much more than the 50 people attending a seminar at CCA, we'll be able to download the podcast and listen to some discussion or to use a website to operate in a different way. So at the moment in which we are, we only have arrived at this conclusion that an institution like CCA also has to face this problem, and has to face this problem in a very clear way, that honestly, there will be always a building. This is a photo of this photographer Takeyama from the hotel you see in the back of the CCA. I like this image because you don't see the building too much. But that will be also the other component, that from now on, all the institution will be composed of two parts. One will be the physical space, and the other will be a kind of building in the clouds. And this is true for institutions like CCA, and I think it will become true again for education in general and for universities too. You also have the advantage of an experiment of the 60s and 70s, like Open University in England, which could be interesting to rethink. So we are facing a moment which is very interesting for all of us, both as architect, urban planner, designer, landscape architect, interior designer, and as institution. Schools, universities, museum. I think that we have really an incredible opportunity to think a little bit out of the box, but in order to address these issues, but also I think that we can't go very far if we are not able to question the assumption on which we operate. The result of this questioning perhaps sometimes is a little bit confused, is never very clear. Everything will become clear in 10, 20 years, as everything looks as clear to us when we look at the work of Stirling, Rossi, Mata Clark, Price, at least a little bit clearer. So that is the risk that we have to take. I like really to we found working on the archive of Mata Clark this card, which is in his An Architecture series, which is composed of a lot of small cards and some photographs, which I think is very, very compelling, and at least is telling us what we have to try to do today. So thank you very much.